the stars. If it feels right, then aim for my heart. If you feel like it, take me away. Good evening, everybody, and happy Sunday night to all of you. This is Unlock the Middle. My name is Dean Packard, the principal at Charlton Middle School, and alongside me are my good friend and co-host, Principal Chris Starczewski of Dudley Middle School in Dudley, Massachusetts. Tonight, we are streaming live on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube, and we are not going to disappoint. We are heading straight into the midsection of our country to bring out a giant, a legend in the field of education. We've had an opportunity to speak to him a little bit in the pregame speech here, but I'm telling you, really looking forward to Sunday night. Chris, you know how excited I get about these nights because we get a chance to bring in authors, educators, just pioneers in the field of education from around the country and just talk about things that really excite us as educational leaders. So first and foremost, Chris, hi, how are you? Hope you had a great weekend. I know we're gearing up to go back to school next week.
Man, Dean, right back at you. Yeah, of course. The weekend was great. It's always good to rest and relax and spend time with family. Hope you were able to do that a bit. Got back from a little bit of travel, had a little bit of rest and relaxation, and now we're getting back at it. But like you mentioned, man, tonight's guest, wow. Yeah. We've read his books. We've heard him speak. And during the pregame, I got to tell you, there's an instant connection towards great that's coming out of our guest this evening. What do you say we hit it and get it at it?
Yeah. Let's do it. Okay. Why don't you bring him in. You take care of the bio. And without any further ado, let's bring in Mr. Todd Whitaker.
All right, everybody. Dr. Todd Whitaker, thanks for joining us tonight. He has been fortunate to be able to blend his passion with his career. That is always something special. He's recognized as a leading presenter in the field of education, as many of you out there know. His message about the importance of teaching has resonated with hundreds of thousands of educators around the world. Todd is a professor of educational leadership at the University of Missouri and a professor emeritus at Indiana State University. He spent his life pursuing his love of education by researching and studying effective teachers and principals. Prior to moving into higher ed, he was a math teacher and basketball coach in Missouri. Kind of a combination of you and I, Dean, which is really amazing to see. Todd then served as a principal at a middle school, a junior high, and the high school level. He was also a middle school coordinator in charge of staffing, curriculum, and technology for the opening of new middle schools. One of the nation's leading authorities on staff motivation, teacher leadership, principal effectiveness, Todd has written over 50 books, including the national bestseller, What Great Teachers Do Differently. Other titles that you definitely want to check out, Dealing with Difficult Teachers, 10 Minute in Service, Your First Year, What Great Principals Do Differently, Motivating and Inspiring Teachers, and Dealing with Difficult Parents. Todd is a home of educators. He's married to Beth, who is a former teacher and principal, who's currently a faculty member of educational leadership at the University of Missouri and professor emeritus at Indiana State as well. And together they have three amazing children, Catherine, Madeline, and Harrison. Todd, how are you tonight?
Wow, that's quite an introduction. That's really all the time we have. I hope everybody's good. And I'm doing great. I'm just hoping I see this is videocast number 34. That's correct.
34.
Yes, sir.
Well, depending on how mine goes, it's going to determine if there's a 35. I didn't know that was
correct.
Well, definitely be a 35. Hey, the burning question I have right now, Beth is the superintendent in your household, right? Is that correct?
She's the superintendent of my life, yes.
There you go.
Exactly, yes.
Great answer.
Last month, we were married 34 years.
Fantastic. Congratulations.
Yeah, she said it's been 16 years of the happiest years of her life, and I'm glad we made the teens. It was a long time before we made the teens, but it's just great, and she's a former principal, been to the White House and all that kind of stuff, and but it's a true treat to join you, Chris and Dean, and I'm very excited and looking forward to it. I'm a diehard middle school guy, as you know, so this is very exciting for me.
We know this awesome. Pulls it all together for us, the triangle. Hey, let's dig right into this and let's talk a little bit. Why look at great? What does great mean? Why do we have to look through the lens of trying to, and Chris and I always say, how do you go from good to great? But looking at great as that example word, let's talk about that a little bit from your mindset, according to the book.
Sure, I'd be happy to. I did want to also notify the people who are watching, just a little quick reminder. the camera adds 10 pounds and I got like seven cameras on me right now. So if you could do the math, that'd be very helpful as we go along. So I'm going to tell you, I'm business on top and party on the bottom, but it's going to take a long time for people to get that image out of them. So why do we look at great? Because we're in education. I mean, that's really it, because we're in education. You know, I work with businesses, I work with lots of other areas, but they just don't matter as much. And what we do matters. And think about this. You know, somebody asked me the other day, Todd, they go, Todd, how can a school build better relationships with parents? And I said, that's simple. Make sure every single kid has a great teacher. Because if your son or daughter has a great teacher, you have a great relationship with that school. And if your son or daughter doesn't, you can't. It's impossible. So what else is it that's going to make any difference besides the great teachers? Think about this. You know, about a year ago now, we went virtual overnight in schools all around the world. I work all around the world. And how many teachers and principals, when you went virtual, could name three teachers you knew were going to figure it out? And how many of you could name three teachers that weren't going to figure it out? And it's understanding that. And I'm writing a book now called How to Get All the Teachers to Be Like the Best Teachers, because that's the only solution I can figure out to education. In every school in the world, at least one teacher's cracked the Da Vinci Code. At least one teacher's figured it out. We don't need anything new. All this stuff about innovation, that's crazy. Think about this. So tell me, what your best teacher, you really need them to innovate, or do you need to replicate them? You know, you don't need them to do anything different. Actually, you kind of wish they wouldn't do anything different, depending on what it is they do. And so we have it in our schools. We just have to figure out how to replicate. Think about this. In every school, there are at least a few teachers that will treat every student with respect and dignity every single day. And in every school, there's a few teachers that don't even know it's possible. And the difference between the best people and everyone else is a cavern, not a sliver. It's like they're not even in the same profession. But we have people who have figured it out. The challenge is other people are threatened by them, including principals. And the reason is, think about this. You know why people don't like the great teachers? They ruin it for the rest of us. Think about it. They teach the kids that everybody else says can't be taught. They reach the kids that people say can't be reached. And they do it in the same school with the same students, with the same principal, with the same budget as all the other teachers. So instead of being threatened by them, what we have to do is we have to figure out what it is they do and then teach everybody else how to do it. So that's kind of a little bit where it goes, because it's because we're in education.
I think you're absolutely spot on. And, you know, we look at that change from, you know, March 12th last year into the virtual world that we're in. You're absolutely spot on when you say, you know, who do we think could manage that out of the gate? Even our best teachers struggled coming out of the gate, but they picked it up quickly. And those are the type of teachers you do want to replicate. And you want that momentum to carry throughout the buildings. Chris and I are blessed. We have a bunch of really, really strong educators that do get it. So I love that you said that. But there is the other half. That other half is, and it's, you see them coming along, which is good. And they're starting to see that this can be done. And all it is simple adjustments. Simple adjustments. That's it.
For the most part, and what it really is I always feel this way. I think we need, when I was a principal, I needed my teachers to do two things, just two things. And if they do these two things every day, we can make them outstanding. And those two things are care and try. And, you know, think about this. Have you ever worked with a teacher that if they just cared and tried every day, they'd be dramatically better? And by willing to care and try, think about this. When we went virtual and you said you could name three teachers that you knew were going to figure it out, it wasn't the three best at technology. It was the three best at teaching, three best at being vulnerable, three best at learning, three best at seeking help from others, three best at contacting the students and asking what to do. And those characteristics. And then what happens? The three people that couldn't figure out virtually, when we came back in person, they still haven't figured it out. Because it's the same skill set that people have or don't have. The other thing to keep in mind, though, is I really believe teachers want to be great. Nobody got into education to be average.
Yep.
Nobody got into education to be that forgettable teacher. They got into education to be great. We just have to help them be great. Yep. And I think we can do it. And that's the difference between the best principals teach the teachers. The average principals teach the students.
You're 100%, you know, right on. And I think you alluded to this next, you know, topic, you know, a little bit. It's about people, not programs. Can you dive into Todd Whitaker's perspective on the concept? It's people, not programs.
Sure. I get, are you all familiar with flexible seating?
Sure.
Alternative seating?
Yeah.
How many of you, and there's only two of you, so I guess you can raise your hand if you want. Can people see you all too?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, man, that's going to kill
us. We're all live.
That's going to kill us. So anyhow, how many of you could name at least one great teacher that would be great using flexible seating?
Oh, yeah.
How many of you could name one great teacher that would, at least one great teacher that would be great not using flexible seating?
Yeah.
So you have trouble naming a great teacher that what doesn't need flexible seating to be great? They'd be great not using flexible seating, right?
Oh, yeah.
How many of you can name one ineffective teacher that would be ineffective with flexible seating?
Oh, yeah.
How many of you could name one ineffective teacher that would be ineffective not using flexible seating? What is not the variable?
The flexible,
flexible seating.
Yeah.
And what's weird, couldn't I have inserted anything?
Yeah.
You know, I talk a lot about classroom management because classroom management is selfish. Everybody does the best they know how. And think about what percent of our teachers would like their job better if they were better at managing their classroom. 100%. Yeah. But what percent would significantly like their job better? That'd be a pretty large percentage, at least a third or a fourth of the people, maybe more than that. And we do the best we know how at classroom management. Well, think about, I talk about clip up, clip down in an example. And it's interesting because once in a while I'll get pushback. And people will go, oh, we don't allow clip up, clip down in our school because it humiliates the kids, you know, to have a chart with their name. I go, clip up, clip down doesn't humiliate the kids. The teacher does.
Yep.
If the best teacher in your school used clip up, clip down, how many years would they have to teach before they'd ever humiliate a kid? They'd never do it. And an ineffective person that humiliates kids using clip up, clip down, take away clip up, clip down, and what's still going to be there? Humiliating the kids. And that's how come this is all so important related to that, if this makes any sense. You got two ways to improve your school, hire better teachers and improve the ones you have. And you have two ways to improve your district, hire better principals and improve the ones you have. Everything else, you're literally chasing your tail. And we do so much tail chasing in education, it's unbelievable.
And that's prevalent everywhere. That's, you know, you see that in every school district that you go to, I'm sure.
Right.
I mean, we all have our pockets. And again, and how to polish and make those pockets shine, that's what great leaders can do. And you know, and even teachers can affect that. Teachers within the classroom and within their own colleagues, they can just continue to model, continue to have that glow, that shine, and just do what they believe is right. And I think that begins to permeate.
Right. So, yep. I think it's the difference between teaching people how to do it and telling them how to do it.
Yeah.
You know, that if we teach people, I think they'll do it. Especially when you think of classroom management, that sounds simple, but it's because it's selfish. So I know you're doing the best you can at classroom management, you know. And so do you all have children?
Yes.
Yes.
If any of you could get your children to behave better, what would you go ahead and do?
Hold them accountable.
You'd get them to behave better because it benefits who?
Benefits
ultimately,
them.
Everybody. It benefits
you. That's a command. But if I told you, think about this. If I told you to get your kids to behave better, you'd launch back at me.
Yeah.
You'd go into defense or attack mode. But if I taught you to, you'd follow me around like the Pied Piper. And what happens is most leaders don't teach us. Most leaders, y'all ever been told to raise your test scores?
Yeah.
Okay. Were you holding back on that one? Were you leaving a little slack in the line, or did you have your test scores up a size you knew how to get them?
Exactly.
Well, we've increased to a level that we could. I mean, we look at the whole child in the teaching. What teaching raises test scores? Good teaching.
And guess why someone? Why would someone at central office or the State Department tell you to raise your test scores instead of teaching you?
Because it validates the money being spent.
Because they don't know how.
Fair enough.
Because if they knew how, guess what they do?
Show us the way.
Because it makes who look good?
The system.
Yep. It makes them look good.
Yeah.
And we have to realize, so when we as principals tell people to do it instead of teaching them, everyone knows we don't know how to do it.
Right.
Because if we knew how to do it, we'd be teaching you because it makes me look good. You know, it makes us look good. And I don't mean that in a negative way or an egotistical way. It's just the way it is.
Yeah.
You know, well, that doesn't mean you don't care about the students also, but you care about you too. You know, the high achievers always do.
Yeah. Let's take this and pivot and go into the relationship side of things and why relationships are so important. It's more about relationships than anything else, as you know. And in your book, you really articulate on that topic itself. So, and we see it all the time. A child can't learn until a child knows that you care about them. And same, the parents feel the same way. So that relationship piece is everything.
that relationship piece is almost everything. Okay. One way to think about it is, you know, I shared before we came on the air, I'm a middle school guy, and my first book was dealing with difficult teachers, because you can't hide an ineffective teacher at the middle school, because every day the kids are on the hunt for weakness. Every day they're looking for weakness, you know. And so the thing to realize, though, is if a teacher does not have engaging lessons, relationships are not enough, because this isn't a dinner party. This is a whole year. That takes a lot. And if we have a teacher that has engaging lessons, they have what's called a learning relationship. And there's only so many times I can ask you about your puppy. And think about this. You all have children. Would you rather your teacher have outstanding lessons every day, or the teacher go to your child's basketball game?
Outstanding lessons every day.
And you know what's weird? If they don't have outstanding lessons, they don't really even care if they come to the basketball game.
Nope.
Good point.
And if they have outstanding lessons, you don't care if they come to the basketball game. Hmm. And it really is like, so there's a learning relationship in there. It isn't just glad handing. And there's nothing wrong with that. The reason we talk about relationships so much is the 5% of the people who don't have them, it glows like a neon.
Yep. Yeah.
But the very best people, some of them don't even, they never go to a basketball game. And I'm not being critical, it's a positive, and I don't mean that in a negative way. But what you're really concerned about is every day they have engaging lessons, and there's a learning relationship in there. And that's so deep that everything else can flow from that. And so it is relationships, but it's not in a superficial way. And so, you know, I tell people, you know, if it isn't a dinner party, if you want to have a great dinner party, honestly, invite me. I'm not kidding. It'll be the funnest dinner party you've ever had in your life. But after 90 minutes, my act gets pretty old. You know, I told people, if I was single, do you know what my strength would be? Speed dating. In 2 minutes, you think I'm the greatest catch you've ever had. But after 34 years, I literally have broken my wife's spirit to live. I mean, so understand this. But the great teachers, that's how come they do it every day. They do something every day. And it involves teaching and learning. And that's the foundation of the relationship.
Todd, before you ask a question, I just want to dig a little deeper with that engaging lesson from your lens. Give me an example. If you got a 60-minute block, and you don't need to go off on a full dissertation about it, what would you say would make for an engaging lesson? Just some thoughts.
A highly effective teacher. Describing anything else is just it's too individual. Think about this. One of the things, and I have never read any of my books, and I'm really not kidding. And somebody told me the other day, I'm the only person they know who's written more books than they've read. And so keep that in mind. But poor lecturer's classroom. Okay. Have either of you ever been in a poor lecturer's classroom?
Yes.
Okay. And when I say poor lecturer's classroom, which is those three words is the problem. And I'm going to make it easy on you. I'm going to eliminate the word classroom.
Poor.
Poor.
Right. But do you know what 95% of the people answer?
Lecture.
Lecture. Because you know what's strange? Y'all are in middle school. Middle school's tough. Everything's tough. What's interesting, though, is your best teacher uses lecture some of the time. Yep. Did you know there's a chance your best teacher uses lecture a lot of the time? And you know what they are? Mm-hmm. Good at it. They're really good at it. And you know what makes it so important? They're able to always read the kids. Who understands, who doesn't? They're able to bring things to life. They're able to, through storytelling, do this. Your worst teacher also may use lecture. So our temptation is, the reason that ineffective teacher's ineffective because they lecture. No, it's because they're not good at it. And what happens is, if you try to then say reduce lecture by 20%, you do understand you're taking away the best gift of the best teacher. And you know what else you're taking away? The best gift of the worst teacher. Do you know why they're using lecture? Because their next best teaching technique is worse. And so I think it's like, everything's situational. So to describe, your three best teachers can be completely different. Their styles can be different. One of them may have flexible seating. One of them may have groups and tables. One of them may just have kids in rows. One of them may have lots of interaction. One of them may be instructor driven. They're just good at it. And I think our mistake is when we think that there's a magic bean, that's what makes people. So my two daughters are masters at classroom management. I've written a couple of books with them. Their personalities are completely different. They look alike. One of them is just like me. Like, I'm the only person in Columbia, Missouri. I've kept my swimming pool open the whole winter. It was minus eight, and I swam a mile 2 days ago. And it's because I got a burn off energy. I'm not allowed, my daughter and I are, we're not allowed to have caffeine in nine states. I mean, this is what we're at. My other daughter's blood pressure is four. But they do certain things in managing their classroom that no one else in their school does. So we can teach some of those things, but their approach and how they teach are dramatically different. So I know people love to say, you see people doing this and you see students doing this. And I don't believe that's true. I think it's much more complicated than just a cookie cutter of that, if that makes sense.
So the word creativity has to be embedded in any, and that can go in any direction. If you're creative, you're going to be able to sustain engagement with kids.
You know, the word I always look for is effective.
Yeah.
Right. They're effective at what they do. You know, it's funny. Somebody talked to me the other day about they're at a middle school and they have kids who don't bring pencils to class. I know that's not true in the East Coast, but it's true over the rest of the country. And it's interesting because they told me they have a teacher that when instead of just giving a kid a pencil every day, the kid has to give the teacher a shoe. Yeah. Okay. In exchange for the pencil. And they go, as a matter of fact, I have two teachers that do that. And I go, oh, how's it working? And they go, in one class, like a well-oiled machine. The kids think nothing of it. One kid comes in every day, takes off a shoe, grabs a pencil. Nobody thinks anything of it. In the other classroom, another kid grabs the shoe, throws it out the window. The teacher talks about, what's that stinky smell? And so what happens, though, because if a principal isn't effective, they eliminate kids giving shoes for pencils. And what happens is you've taken away the best tool that worst teacher has. Right. And you know how you get rid of ineffective lecturers from lecturing? Teach them how to do something better.
Yeah.
Then they eliminate lecture simply because they have something better than lecturing ineffectively, if that makes sense. So I think it's teaching's way more complicated than just this and this and this. But we pretend, if you get on social media, you pretend it is. In my book, What Great Principals Do Differently, I just wrote a chapter called Leadership's Not an Event. And we make so many things like they're events on social media and they're not events.
We do.
So they're not. And there's nothing wrong with events. It's sort of like a principal kissing a pig. If you're good, they're laughing with you. If you're bad, they're laughing at you. But either way, they're laughing.
Yep.
And it didn't do anything to move the score. And I'm not being critical of it. I love events. I love things like that. I'm not being critical of it at all. But that's not the solution to anything. Moriarty just posted on there, you're only as strong as your weakest link. I think you're only as strong as your strongest link. If I'm given the power to my weakest link, who did I just say is the most important teacher in the entire school? I can't do that. If all of our schools are only as strong as our weakest link, we might as well shut our schools down. Isn't your school really as strong as your strongest link? Isn't that what it really is? Vince Lombardi said that. Yeah. So if I say I'm only as strong as my weakest link, so I'm giving all the power to the night custodian. If they're not very good, I don't know. I'm giving the power to my very best teachers because I can help. They're the ones moving our school anyhow. The others aren't.
Well, that's the key. You know, when we talk about effectiveness and we talk about, you know, being able to teach to our strengths and being able to read the room and identify what the students need and what the students are getting out of our presentation as classroom teachers, as principals, you know, when we read the room of the faculty meeting, we want to ensure that we're putting, you know, the people's needs first. And, you know, DMS, my building, Dudley Middle School and Charlton Middle School, are very strong in terms of belief in students first. We have those two words posted on the front of our building, literally students first, right outside the principal's office above my windows. Focusing on students first, you know, in terms of great schools, how is it that some people have figured this out and what is it that others could do in order to focus on students first?
I think the thing is we can all say we do things. Tell me a teacher that doesn't say students first. Sure. Now, everybody knows how to say it. It's just the hard part is we don't know how to do it or we don't do it. And so it's also, I think, realizing as a principal, it isn't students first, it's teachers first. I've got to make sure somebody asks, what can a principal do to help students? And I said, help the teachers. My job as a principal is to take care of the teachers. The teacher's job is to take care of the students. And don't your best teachers do it? Don't they do it all the time? Yep. And other people don't do it. And so I can't reach down into the students. That's too far. And of course, I'm always thinking students first, but the only way to be successful for students is to be successful for teachers. Yep. If you get a call from an irate parent and you don't know who the kid, who the teacher is that the parent's mad at. And they said, the teachers told their kid to shut up, loser. Do you have to glance at your whole roster to figure out which teacher said it, or do you already have it eliminated down to three?
Hopefully you've got it targeted into one area.
Right. Yeah. And the sad thing is you do have it targeted.
Yeah.
So I just came up with something on Saturday. I don't know if this is going to make any sense, and you all probably don't want to go in this direction anyhow, but what the heck.
What's your...
I've already commented on people's comments that probably made them mad, so all I can do is just keep going. Let's pretend that, and this is the way to think of a school. Let's pretend, because right now February is tough. You know, the honeymoon's long been over and the end ain't near in sight, and this is a wacky year anyhow. Let's pretend that on a 1 to 10, each one of your teachers has a personal morale level. And let's pretend right now, because it's a tough time of year, the morale is between a 2 at the bottom, the teacher who's least positive right now has a 2, and the teacher who's at the very top in your school has an 8. Okay, the time of year, it's just worn out, we're all whipped. So a 2 to an 8. Okay, does this make sense? And everybody mm-hmm. else is somewhere in between. You know what's really strange? If I'm a principal and I try to improve my morale by going, instead of a 2 to an 8, all I'm going to try to do is go from a 3 to a 9. Okay? What's interesting is, think about this. If I am at a 2 to an 8 and I try to go to a 3 to a 9, which teacher is most threatened?
The one on the lower end.
The 2. Because there isn't room for them anymore.
Right.
And you know what's strange? They don't want to go to a 3.
Yep.
It makes them uncomfortable. But the power of your best people, and this is why I said you're only as strong as your strongest link. The power of the best people is, if I handle this wrong, I do something where I go, I'm going to give a teacher of the day award, and I think that'll help morale, but instead I give it to the same teacher 3 days in a row, and they end up keying her car in the parking lot. One of the things that happens is then, all of a sudden, the 8s, what I've done now is I've moved it down to a 1 to a 6.
Yep.
But the difference is this. The 2 fights against going to a 3 for selfish reasons. The 8 fights against going to a 6 because they know that hurts the school. Think in a school, in any school, how many teachers every day in a school are truly on the side of the principal? Every day. It's not a whole lot. But there's a lot of them on the side of the principal, depending on how things are going, what time of year it is, what the last decision was. And then there's certain people that would like it if they could make the principal cry. And so what happens is the one that is always on the side of the principal, they want the principal to be successful because that makes the school successful. They're always looking out from the school point of view. And I think that's how come we've got to focus on the very best teachers. Because I always say, if you make every decision based on your best teachers, you never make a wrong decision.
And in the end, it'll pull the bottom up. But that makes a lot of sense.
Right. But you know, even if they don't pull, that's my job. Their job is, it's interesting because people feel like, I hear all the time that principals say to teachers, the teachers should stand up to negative teachers. That's my job. You know what I used to tell my teachers all the time? How about I take care of the adults, you take care of the students. So if you have a challenging parent coming in, I'll take care of them. Don't worry. And I don't mean I'm usurping your power. Maybe it'll be you and I together. I'm going to give you the power to do it. I'm going to do whatever I can. Mm-hmm. If there's a bully teacher and another teacher stands up to him, they just bully somebody else in the school. If there's a bully teacher and the principal effectively stands up to him, they won't bully anybody else in the school.
That's a good point.
We think that somehow peers can fix peers, and they can't. That's why there is a principal. You said you have children. Do you all expect your children to fix their friends?
No.
Do you expect your children to do what's right even when their friends do wrong?
Yes.
You know what I expect my teachers to do? I expect them to do what's right even when the other teachers do wrong. And it's my job to deal with the ones that are wrong.
That's fair.
It's a different.
Very fair.
And it takes the pressure off the teachers, I think. Yeah. It takes the pressure off all the good teachers.
Yeah. And allows them to do what they're supposed to do and work with kids. It makes a lot of sense.
Sure. Right.
It makes a lot of sense. Hey, what is this 10 out of 10? Help me understand what that means. One of the essential items from the book.
10 out of 10?
10 out of 10.
It's that in my opinion, we treat every single student with respect and dignity every single day, 10 days out of 10. And I think the principal has to treat every single adult with respect and dignity every single day out of 10, 10 days out of 10. And that's not the maximum, that's the minimum. And the way I share it with my teachers and with other teachers, the way I share it with them is, How many days out of 10 do you want students treating you with respect and dignity? How many days out of 10 do you want students to come into your class prepared, responsible, and ready to learn? And if we expect that 10 days out of 10 with students, and we should, we have to expect it out of ourselves. And so that's where that comes from. And it's every single day. You know, it's funny. I wrote with my daughters, I wrote a book on classroom management, and there's three components of classroom management we've shared. One of them is relationships. One of them is expectations, which is appropriate and engaging lessons. And the third one is consistency, that you do it every day.
Yep.
And the hardest one for us to do is consistency. Yep. And the easiest one for us to do, believe it or not, is relationships. And so, and that's where the 10 days out of 10 is every day. We treat tons of teachers greet the kids the first day of school. How many teachers greet the kids on February 21st when they're worn down?
Yeah.
Not many, because it's Sunday, but February 22nd when they're less worn down. Yeah. And it's that's the way the best people do it.
Right.
It's interesting. And you know what? It's simple, and it hones in on, you know, really, you know, core values, you know, as educators and as people. I love the simplicity behind a major idea in developing culture and you know, really moving towards a mission. but, you know, as we sit down and we talk about, you know, students first, we talk about the learning relationships and the other relationships that we have. Empathy comes into mind. And, you know, part of this book is, you know, putting yourself in their position. Talk a little bit about that from the leadership perspective, I think would be really helpful.
Sure. It's interesting because people will talk about the fact that there'll be a principal and they forgot what it was like to be a teacher because they haven't taught in 10 years or whatever. That's not their weakness. It's the weak inability to put themselves in another person's position. No matter what your position is, you haven't taught everything in your school. Right. You haven't also been the night custodian. You also haven't been the in food service. You also haven't been the office receptionist. You also haven't been the school bus driver. Now, you may have been one or two days. I mean, I was a substitute bus driver while I was a principal, and my entire goal was to make sure none of the bus drivers got sick. Trust me. But but if you're able to think about this, how hard would it be to be the night custodian in a building by yourself and actually work every day? That'd be hard. But if we don't think like that, one of the things I talk about in teaching is you have to teach the bus drivers how to manage kids. Because if not, they start to hate the kids. And it's, you know, and I'm sure their salaries are great and I'm sure the training's rich and deep, but we have to teach them how to do this. And all you have to think about is I've seen teachers that have trouble managing 25 kids in front of them. Think how hard it is to manage 66 kids behind you while you're driving a school bus. And I have to be in classrooms. The number one reason I'm in classrooms as a principal is so everybody can see how we treat the kids.
Yeah.
How we talk to them, how we say please and thank you, how we say ladies and gentlemen. Because if I don't teach that and I don't reinforce that, that's always going to be missing in classrooms. And then there's going to be components that aren't ever going to make a difference. And you can't build a relationship by being nice when you're in a good mood. You have to build a relationship all the time through everything we do. Because people stop trusting you if you only do it when you're in a good mood to them. Yeah. And your teacher teaches this. And I think they get it. I truly do. I think it makes a huge difference.
And I think kids see that. They see through their own lens. They can pick that stuff up so easily. My gosh, especially in the middle school level. You said it earlier. They're like vultures. They're going to go after the weakest link.
And that's right.
And it's just what they do. And you just don't want to be part of that link.
No. And we're all, and you know what? We're all 13.
Yeah, we are.
We're all 13. We are. And you have to understand that as a leader in terms of, does this embarrass a teacher? Everybody wants to fit in. Everybody wants to be a part of something. You know, you have to have groups of teachers welcoming the new teachers that it's intentional, because there's always going to be another group of teachers welcoming the new teachers.
Right.
You know, and it's like students. If you think of high achieving kids, average kids, and kids that have problems, which of those three groups will always welcome a newcomer? The kids that have problems.
Right.
And so you've got to have a group that welcomes the teachers so that when you hire a new teacher, you only have the one goal. That's for your school to become more like a new teacher, not for the new teacher to become like the school. And so I've got to link people up with the positive people and continue to build that culture that way.
Todd, sadly, our world still centers around standardized tests. And I hate to say it centers around, let's just say it's at a finish line for every year where we have that point to be able to validate where we are in comparison to our peers and schools of similar demographics.
Right.
Now, let's talk about the standardized test for a second and where it fits in with the adolescent development of kids from a middle level. And, you know, where's the importance? We know that good teaching practices outweighs any test preparation that could ever be. Because if you focus on solid teaching, test results take care of themselves. It's like a practice plan that is so well oiled that when you go out and play the game is fun and easy. If you get everything done in the classroom or on the court, that takes care of itself. So let's just back up and talk about standardized tests and where you see them right now as a vehicle that really helps drive schools or really holds us back. Where do you stand with that?
Well, what's interesting is when testing started, it was a reference based in which then kids would get results in third grade and get results in fourth grade, and you compare this student to this student. And then what's happened is we've taken the same tests and somehow or another, now we normal. And all of a sudden there's percentile rankings. And realize with every standardized test then, when we do percentile rankings, half the group has to be below average. And what have states done? If schools improve, they change the test so that the schools stop improving. Isn't that what happens in every state? And couldn't you, and the other thing I think that's funny, it's like when people talk now during the pandemic, kids have fallen behind. Fallen behind what? Fallen behind what? That's just made up. It's sort of like, what's a third grade reading level? You do know that's made up, don't you? That isn't something. It's just made up. And so the same way with standardized tests, couldn't you develop a standardized test that every one of your kids would pass? Mm-hmm. And couldn't you develop a standardized test that none of your kids would pass?
Yep.
And I know we have a lot of standardized tests that no legislators could pass, but that's not related to the test. That's a joke, and you can edit that out or leave it live. And any legislators, somebody said, don't you think every legislator should teach for 3 years before they get on the legislation? And I said, we can't afford the remediation. but the other thing that I think is really important is that we also promote it when we have success and belittle it when we don't. And I think as a school, we have to be cautious. You know, one of the things that has taught parents that, you know, a lot of states do A, B, C, D ratings with schools and all this. One of the things that have taught parents that an A is really important is the school that got an A.
Yeah.
You know, you put a giant sign in front of your school. We're an A. Congratulations. We send thing. The next year we get a B. And you know what we're thinking? We probably shouldn't have promoted that A, you know, last time because we have two kids from Alaska that scored below this in this one narrow section. And now it knocked us down to a B. We also do the promoting. And I think that's really critical that we have to put thought on how much we've promoted this too. The problem with standardized tests is very simple, is they do not measure the treatment. They measure the outcome. And I say it's like having a diet ad with one of the Olsen twins in which you're going, boy, that diet must be good. She's really skinny. And I'm going, she was pretty skinny when she started. I think she's gained 2 pounds, you know. And it's so you have schools that are at the going to be at the 95th percentile if you literally close school down for 3 years. And you open them up and they're going to be at the 95th percentile. And we have to acknowledge that. The other challenge is that we've got to then offer support for schools that need more support. And many times that isn't what happens. In many states, to be honest with you, the schools with the highest socioeconomic populations, they're protected. Many states have situations where we're gonna only give schools funding for growth, but if you're at the 90th percentile, you go ahead and get funding anyhow. What is that? I mean, and I think they should. I just meant, what is that? That's really, we're just gonna protect the haves,
right,
and attack the have-nots. And yeah, it's the ranking in comparison. It's not the information. It's the ranking in comparison. That's the part that's disingenuous in schools. They're not the same. We pretend they're the same. And, you know, and it's just a mistake.
You know, anyway. I'd love to see, we've had other shows on this and we're talking about reinventing schools and with COVID-19, now is the time to really rethink and reestablish what schools should be doing. I mean, we've shown great resilience as educators across the nation in making changes and adapting. And, you know, why not? And again, we could go off on a tangent for this for an hour, but there's no better time than the present to start thinking about what tomorrow is going to look like.
Yeah. What do they say? Never waste a good crisis.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's an excuse to do whatever we want to do.
Correct.
But the thing we still want to do is we just want to make sure everybody has really good teachers. It isn't a reinvention. It's a replication. I really believe this. I mean, it sounds funny. I've just seen schools that have identified two or three of their top teachers, and then they figured out how to make sure when we hire someone, they get linked with them. Think about this. Do you all ever do mentors in your school?
Sure.
Okay. What's the number one word principals use that principals use to determine who's the mentor? It's convenience. Who's at the same grade level? Who has the same subject? Who's the same gender? Who has the same race? Who coaches or doesn't coach? Who has the same plan time? Whose rooms are near each other? And when I get a new teacher and I assign them a mentor, do you know what I'm saying to them? This is the peak of the mountain. Right. This is exactly what I want you to become. Student teachers. How do we give student teachers? Whose turn it is? Who's willing to do it? If you give a student teacher to an average teacher, you literally have limited their career. And we're doing it based on, we don't want to hurt somebody's feelings because they want a student teacher. I don't want to ruin someone's career because somebody wants a student teacher. And if I give them, think about this, if you have an average student teacher, average skill, and they're with your best teacher, in 1 week, who do they start to dress like? And in 2 weeks, who do they start to talk like? And in 3 weeks, who do they start to teach like? Yep. And in 1 year, who do they dress like? And in 2 years, who do they talk like? And in 3 years, who do they teach like? And yep. Give them to an average teacher. In 1 year, 1 week, it's the same thing. And we do this all the time. And it's because we're always afraid of our ineffective people. It's the most amazing thing because they're the ones that'll pitch a fit. When you try to move morale, remember, from a 2 and an 8 to a 3 and a 9, it's the 2 that throws the fit.
Yeah, yeah.
We had Sean Deeryard, who does the Celebrate Monday. And he was on working with us on Saturday with a group. And somebody goes, well, I did in our school, and our teachers pitched a fit about it. And I go, your teachers did? And they go, well, two of them were really upset. And you know what I said? Which two? Who are you giving the power to? If it's the best two, they're upset because they think it's embarrassing or offending, in effect, other teachers. If it's the worst two, and I don't mean you want to insult them, I'm just saying I can't let them make the decisions in my school.
Yep.
And in many schools, it's sort of like, do you know how come I could be in class? My last school had 1,350 middle school kids. Do you know how come I could be in classrooms every day? Do you know what I taught my teachers? The kid who gets sent to the office is the least important student in the school, and let's quit making him out to be the most important student in the school. And I'm always going to be respectful, and nobody supports teachers like I do. But I'm not in a hurry. Why am I in a hurry to get to that kid in the office when there isn't a teacher in the school in a hurry to get the kid back?
Mm-hmm.
And so I spend time with 1,349 kids doing right rather than one kid doing wrong. And I'm going to deal with them, and I'm going to deal with them as effective. And if your secretary is good, they can deal with three dysfunctional kids better than your three worst teachers can deal with three dysfunctional kids. And it's just, and none of it's rude or disrespectful at all. And I'm going to support you like nobody else, but I have to make that realization or else I spend all my time with the kids that are struggling. Just in behavior. And they're only the least important kid during the time they're in the office. As soon as they go back in class, they're as important as everybody else.
Right.
You see, I don't mean it in a negative way. I'm never going to berate or belittle. It's just they've stopped learning. They were preventing other people from stop learning. So tell me how that's the center focus in my school.
I think that's the point on perspective in terms of prioritizing where you need to leverage your time and your expertise and your visibility. You need to avoid those distractors. And I'm not saying a student in crisis or a student in need of a talk is a distractor. But I agree. You know, if we're able to identify how we need to do our business most effectively to engage our educators, our kids, our stakeholders, that bucks the norm of what folks typically expect the principal or the assistant principal to do, handle all the fires, we're not going to move the needle unless we actually do those types of things. I appreciate you bringing that into this conversation. And
you know who wants you to handle the fires are the people creating the fires.
Yeah.
You know, nobody repeats a behavior without a reward. And so they get a benefit from doing that because we also react to them.
Right.
You're right. You know, and it just, I will. And what's funny is I'm the only principal I know that whenever a teacher sends a kid to the office, I go down and ask the teacher what they think ought to happen.
Yep.
And you know why we don't do it? Because they're going to want the ineffective people who send the most kids to the office are going to want something more than we can give.
Right.
But do you know what I've learned? They're going to, they have an opinion, so they might as well share it with me because they're going to share it with somebody, and nobody in the teacher's lounge can solve their problem.
Right.
So they might as well share it with me. And what I can provide is perspective. The reason I can't do this, because I know he didn't bring a pencil to class, and that is frustrating. I'm never going to be snarky with him. And that's hard because that's my personality. But I understand that about the pencil, then that's frustrating. But we also have another student down there who said, cussed out a teacher. And I've got to differentiate between the two.
Sure.
Because to me, there is a difference. And do you feel like there's a difference? And I ask sincerely, and it's yes. So that's the reason I can't do these things. And I'm very sorry because it's so frustrating when kids don't come prepared, especially chronically. Yep. That is so frustrating. But I say, here are the three things I can do. Which of the three do you want me to do? And I'm teaching them all the time how to think globally instead of how to think in a one direction.
That's it. And, you know, that's the key. And, you know, tonight's topic, Todd, was all about, you know, what do great teachers do differently? What do great educators do differently? And I think just this discussion tonight, and, you know, on behalf of Dean and I, thank you so much, allows us to have entry points and conversations, as well as, you know, anybody who's viewing this to have some additional anchor points of thought on how to become better, you know, tomorrow. What is it I can do differently to move that lever?
You know, what's funny, in a great teacher's classroom, when a kid misbehaves, do you know their first instinct is to keep teaching? Mm-hmm. Because they have 24 kids behaving.
Yeah.
And they decided the kid misbehaving is the least important kid in the class at that time. The average teacher decides that kid who's misbehaving is the most important kid in the class at that time. And they are readily throw the other 24 kids under the bus to stop teaching and learning in the classroom to deal with the one kid and potentially accelerate the kid.
Right.
And we even see people that stop teaching and will say to a kid, would you like to teach? Do you want to take the chalk and teach? Would you like to teach? But they're doing it because they think it's right, because they student taught with someone who did it, because we gave them a mentor who did it, because we've never taught them different. The first thing we have to sort out are people ignorant or insubordinate. We almost always think they're insubordinate, and they're almost always ignorant. And ignorant doesn't mean unintelligent. It means unaware of a better way to do it. That teacher who struggles managing their classroom, don't you think they want their class to be better? Because it helps them.
It sure does.
It sure helps them.
And that's the key. You know, sorry, Dean, on Saturday during Navigating Leadership, our discussion that we had, the hashtag, the shift, and I stress shift with an F, has hit the fan. And as we sit down and
Just
we talk
on
about
YouTube, you can say it with a
We don't want that hashtag to get associated with us with a misspelling, though. But I think if we are talking about shifting and we are talking about the move from good to great, you know, if we're talking Collins, if we're talking about Carol Dweck and the growth mindset on how being exposed to excellence allows us to become more excellent down the line, you know, whatever it is we're talking about, we don't have an opportunity to do it unless we have conversations like this, leaders like you, who are able to articulate these perspectives and be able to bring them out into the public eye and into our ears and ultimately into our heads and hearts. So, yeah, we got to move on. We got to wrap up. This show could go on for hours, man.
Sure. The listeners think it already has. So keep that in mind.
I'm speaking selfishly. I've learned a lot just listening to you, Todd, and I appreciate the lens and the depth of knowledge that you bring to the table. It's common sense driven. A lot of what you're saying, it's not rocket science, you know, and that's what we have to step back and stop and slow down.
It's almost common sense. Yeah. Let me share the limitation. There's so much average, we begin to think average is right. An average teacher does this, so we think it's right. An average principal, how many of you know principals that talk to their whole faculty about one teacher at a faculty meeting? You know, and go, sometimes some of you are coming late, sometimes some of you. They decided the person coming late is the most important person in the room.
Good point.
Yeah.
And you know what the good people are thinking? What are you talking to me for? Why don't you talk to her? She's not even here yet.
Don't waste my time.
And we do this all the time. But we do it because it happens to us. Yeah. And then your teachers do it to the kids. They lecture all the kids because one kid misbehaved. Coaches run all the team because one kid skipped practice. Not me. Yeah. I run one kid because one kid skipped practice.
Yep.
But the other people don't. They punish people for being good. And when you're in that mindset, and what's funny is if you think about yourself, it really is a self-focus. If you think about yourself, you hate it. So you make sure you don't do it to anybody else.
Yep.
And it's really focusing on self. It really isn't focusing on other people. It's how do you feel?
We need to have a part two with Todd Whitaker coming down the road, because I know you could go on forever, man. This is really good stuff. Thank you so much. We appreciate your time.
Well, I am honored, but I just want to thank the people who, the two people who are actually listening or will hear this, because they're the ones making a difference every day. You know, you all work for a living. You all are the ones that make a difference. The leaders in schools have shown the world how to lead. You know, I always say people always look to leaders, but during times of crisis, they stare. And you all have shown the world. The teachers have shown the world what to do. They have done this. Your best teachers, think about this. They have shown how to teach during a pandemic. They've shown everybody how to do it. And you all are absolutely amazing. I just appreciate what you've done. I travel for a living. You all work for a living.
Todd, though, you're grounded in experience and you're grounded in intellect and emotion. So, you know, again, on behalf of Dean and I, we gotta wrap this up. Thank you so much for joining us. Everybody out there, if you don't follow Todd, check him out on Twitter at Todd Whitaker. Books are available on Amazon, and I'm sure in any shops that are out there that deal with education on a regular basis. Go ahead and reach out to us. We can get you hooked up with him or reach out to him directly. Tremendous leader, tremendous lessons. And Todd, thanks very much. Everybody out there in Unlock the Middle Land, be well, be better, just keep on chugging, and have a great, great week ahead.
Thank you all for doing what you do. It makes a difference every day. Thank you.
Thank you.